Welcome to the second session of the APS Investment Chats, a three-day event where we'll discuss the most current investment topics that obviously are going on right now, but this time we'll be discussing them with experts in the field so that all of us out there who won't have the opportunity to hear some very important information will get to do so in this 1 hour. So thank you for being here with us, and we do encourage you to stay on for the full hour. In today's session, we will focus on the importance of saving for retirement. And to help us navigate through this topic, I'd like to introduce you to my guests. We have with us Mark Lamb, Corporate Schemes Manager at the APS Bank. We have Darren Ajous, Corporate Schemes Relationship Manager at APS Bank. And David Spiteri-Gingell, former Chair of Pension Reform. Today, Mark, first and foremost, will be highlighting the value of early financial planning for your retirement. And then following his presentation, we will hold a panel discussion. And in that panel discussion, we will discuss local retirement law and also potential developments. We will have the opportunity to answer some of your questions. So we do encourage you to type in your questions in the Q&A section that we have provided for you, and then we will answer them in the course of our discussion. So without further ado, I will move over to you, Mark. I'll hand it over for your presentation, Build Your Future.
Thank you, Claire. Good evening and welcome. Today, let's give some thought to retirement planning. This is one of the most important building blocks when considering safeguarding one's financial future. If we consider how much time and effort we give planning our annual 1 or 2 week vacation, surely it makes sense to also set some time to one side to plan for the longest holiday of our lives, which is our retirement. But of course, the fact that you have joined us today shows us that you have already taken the most important first step, that of building knowledge on how best to build your future. But let's also have some fun along the way. May I ask, have you seen the TV show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? It's that popular TV show where by answering a series of questions, you can win a million. Well, today our version is Who Wants to Be a Pension Millionaire. Of course, by winning this amount, you probably wouldn't need to plan for your retirement. Your longest holiday would probably start straight away. But today, unfortunately, this is just for fun. I don't have €1 million to give away, unfortunately. But anyway, I hope you will join in. So let's assume that you have answered all the early round questions, and now you're looking to answer those final questions for the final prize. Let's start with this question. The state retirement age for those born after 1962 in Malta is A, 62, B, 63, C, 65, D, 66. What do you think? Have you used up your 50-50? Do you want to phone a friend? No, I think you might know this one. And the answer is 65, of course. So well done. I'm assuming everyone got that question right. So let's go to the final question. So, according to the Mercer CFA 2023 Global Pension Index, which country has the best pension system in the world? Is it A, Denmark, B, Netherlands, C, Iceland, D, Singapore? What do you think? Just imagine for a moment if your whole financial future hung on answering this question correctly for €1 million. You've done no planning, and this is your last chance. No pressure. Anyway, let's answer that question. It's actually B. The Netherlands is deemed to be the country with the best system. And I wish achieving a secure retirement was as simple as correctly answering a few questions. But unfortunately, as you know, it isn't. For the majority of us, we need a plan. Of course, living in a country with a sound pension system certainly helps. The Netherlands score highly because it offers very good benefits, supported by a strong asset base. It has very good legislation, but also it made some difficult choices along the way. For example, their pension age, their state pension age in Holland is 67, minimum 67. Ours here is 65. And also it's compulsory for all companies there to pay into their employees' pension schemes. And of course, it's compulsory for the employees to contribute as well. And did you know that on average, it's nearly or over 20% of the gross salary goes towards pension provision in the Netherlands? So they've made some tough choices, but they've been rewarded with the, which is what deemed to be the best system in the world. And interestingly, on this survey, they looked across 47 countries to get a good gauge of how different countries do it. Of interest, the US, the world's largest economy, came in at 16th place, which is a bit of a shock. Now, in Malta, it wasn't included in the survey, and at the moment it's not compulsory to save for retirement. But that said, our pension system here in Malta is good, and it gives us all generous tax breaks to save for our retirement. And I'll come on to the tax breaks a little bit later. But let's be fair, in life many of us seem to struggle to plan. It's very, 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 very difficult. And if we think about how many days that we've got left until till Christmas, for example, we have 40 days left to Christmas from today. The reality is, I think this year is going to be financially challenging. And if we look at this fascinating slide from the Financial Times, this suggests that the average cost of a Christmas roast dinner will be almost 10% higher this year due to inflation and the rising cost of food. With 40 days to go until Christmas, the good news is if we start planning now and maybe save an extra 5 or 10 euros per day, we would likely cover all the extra costs, the presents, the food, the celebrations. But in reality, how many of us will really do this? And really, it's the same for pensions. Consider this. If they are paid monthly, a 25-year-old has 480 paydays until they retire, while a 40-year-old has just 300. That's 300 opportunities to make provision for hopefully at least 300 monthly drawdowns to fund an action-packed and enjoyable retirement. But returning back to our theme of who wants to be a pension millionaire, let's look at this case study. Noel is 25 years old. He has been employed with his company for the last 2 years and has recently earned a promotion. And his company has awarded him a 5,000 euro per annum increase. Very nice. But they've actually offered Noel a choice. And option A is a salary increase of 5,000, or option B, a salary increase of 2,000 plus 3,000 to go into his company pension scheme. Now, I'm sure Noel's first thought, probably like all of us, is to take the money. Let's take the money and enjoy it. But Noel is a sensible young lad, and so he decides to look into option B a little bit closer. And Noel considers, for example, if he takes the full 5,000 now, it will mean it will all be subject to income tax. By joining his company scheme at a relatively young age, this may mean that when he comes to retire, be able to retire earlier or hopefully richer. And also, by contributing to his company pension scheme himself, he is entitled to a 25% tax credit on his contributions made to that particular scheme. Okay, that's up to 3,000, and it's 25% of that. That gives him a 750 euro back as far as a tax credit. But it's quite a generous tax incentive. I mean, there's not many investments around that's giving a guaranteed annual return of 25%. So this is quite appealing to Noel. But Noel's next step is maybe to do some investment research, because the money's going to be invested somewhere. It can't just be left without any growth. And he wanted to look over a long period of time to see what maybe the average returns have actually been. And during his research, he looked at the S&P 500. Now, the S&P index is one of the most watched stock market indexes in the world. It tracks 500 of America's top companies across a wide range of sectors. And of course, America is the largest economy in the world, and what actually happens there impacts us all usually. So this is a good bellwether for how things have kind of worked out over the years. So first he looked over 5 years, then 10 years, then 20, then 30 years. As you can see, the period in question here, 5 years, is given an annual return of 18.55% per year. The 10-year period, 16.58, 20 years, just over 9.5, and over 30-year period, 10.66%. Pretty good. Probably when you're talking to investment people, they seem a little bit obsessed with this 10% per year figure. In reality, yes, it can be achieved, but this is a long-term projection and it's not a guarantee of the future. And an important consideration for Noel as well is to consider the impact of inflation. And if we build in how inflation worked during those periods of time, you can see the effect of that. And in general, it's knocked the returns down by about 2 or 3%. But this is in real terms and something we really should think about when we're investing, which is the impact of inflation. But still, over that 30-year period, even with that adjusted for inflation, it's over 8% as a return. So he's grouped all that together. And so to summarise, he's considering this option B, 3,000 going in from the company, 3,000 going into his pension, probably from himself. His time horizon is 40 years, taking him up to around his mid-60s. And actually, because Noel is a sensible young chap, he's actually decided to maybe look at a lower than expected return of 6.5% over that term. That allows for some inflation, maybe some charges along the way. So it's a bit more conservative, a bit more realistic, let's say. Of course, that figure is subject to change, and there's no guarantee of future returns, of course. And what he then does, quite cleverly, he plugs this into his calculator, and interestingly, what we actually find with this is that if we look over his full time horizon, and he was successful with his projections, it's actually going to give him a pension pot of over 1 million euros. And if we go into the detail a little bit more, the amount that he's actually invested in that time, it sounds a lot of money, 240,000, but actually he's only paid in half of that himself. The company's paid in half, he's paid in half. And that figure also doesn't allow for the 25% tax credit, which he would be entitled to, which would work out to about 30,000 off of that figure. The rest is the actual anticipated growth that fund has actually achieved during that period of time. So, Noel is being pretty impressed with these figures. And if he sticks to his plan, then of course Noel is on track to becoming to have a pension pot of over 1 million euros. And of course, he doesn't even have to go into a TV studio and answer some crazy questions. So I'm sure you've heard it a million times before. Fail to plan, plan to fail. So I ask you, what's your plan? Well, that concludes my presentation, and I wish you all a very happy Christmas and a prosperous retirement.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Very, very well done. I am sure everybody has been put on their seat and are thinking and taking notes, but that was straight on the point. And I mean, I do have my own questions. Let's start off first with just one question to all our panelists, and then we'll take on some from you, our audience, which I remind you all, you can put in your question, key in your question in the Q&A section, which we have there available for you. So my first question to you, Mark, would be, I'm assuming that I'm asking this question for the people who are employed.
Yeah.
So as well for the employers.
Yeah.
So if you are an employer, how can we actually help the employers, help their employees
yeah.
who want to achieve this objective of becoming a retired millionaire?
Okay, that's a good question. I mean, it's a bit of a stretch to expect all employers to make their employees millionaires. That's not the point, but I think it's certainly in everyone's interest to help their employees plan for their future. And it makes good business sense as well. If you engage with your employees, there's more buy-in with the company, they probably stick around longer. And my final point is it's very tax efficient for the employer as well, because they are also entitled to a 25% tax credit on the amount that they invest in their workforce by putting that into their pension.
Okay.
And at the end of the tax year, on top of that, they can show it as a business cost. So effectively, that comes off their tax bill, so they pay less tax at the end of the year. So it makes good financial sense for everyone.
Yes, very good. Very good points mentioned that will incentivize, hopefully, more employers doing this for and with their employees. Moving on to you, Darren. Lately, I've heard about this terminology, auto-enrollment. So I would first like to explain to us exactly what it means and if this is something that you think Malta will be looking into adopting.
All right, so just to set the scene for the benefit of the audience, Claire. When the pensions legislation was enacted some 5-6 years ago, it was not only a milestone which stopped there. However, it was the start of a process to make saving for retirement the norm.
Yes.
Now, as time goes by, the strain on the social security system is becoming more evident because of the way demographics have been shaping up. In Malta, we do not only have a low birth rate, but we also have a declining birth rate, coupled with the fact that people are living longer. So what does this mean? This means that
less people working.
Less people working.
More people requiring.
Exactly.
To
exactly. Everything. So as time goes by, it is likely that the strain will become even bigger unless something is done about it, right? So private pensions is one of the things that can be done to tackle this problem. So notwithstanding the fact that there are very attractive tax benefits when it comes to occupational pension schemes, just to remain on the topic of what Mark was discussing, uptake has been significantly low. In fact, and the latest
for the private ones,
for the occupational pension schemes.
Okay, all right.
No, in fact, in the latest survey, which was commissioned by APS Bank with regards to uptake of occupational pension schemes, it resulted that only 4% of the whole working population are enrolled in occupational pension schemes.
Okay.
Now, where does auto-enrollment come in? The natural step, next step in the process that I mentioned before is, in my opinion, and in the opinion of many, auto-enrollment.
Which means, of course, it's automatically, you are automatically.
Exactly. So what is auto-enrollment? Basically, as things stand, occupational pension schemes are completely voluntary. Auto-enrollment would make these mandatory in the sense that companies, employers, would have to make these available for their employees, but in all likelihood will not have the obligation to contribute themselves.
Okay.
All right. Likewise, the employees would be automatically enrolled by default, but they would have the option to opt out. So what does this mean? This would eliminate, for example, inertia. It would. It is natural that we do not plan much for the future. Having something set in place would probably increase the uptake.
Because let us face it, I am sure that when it gets in there, you do want to have a good pension. But sometimes laziness or you know, lack of commitment or prioritizing different things in life takes away the attention that you should be having on focusing on your retirement plan.
Exactly.
So this will also help bring people in that would otherwise just say, oh, okay, yeah, maybe next year. Or...
In fact, what is likely to happen, as evidenced from
other countries.
Mm-hmm. Because here we are lucky that we can now base our model on what happened elsewhere, right?
Yes.
Basically, this would give the opportunity to everyone who's in employment, especially those at a young age, to start saving for their retirement. And it would enhance the probability that they would have saved a significant amount by the time they come to retire, which then obviously they can use in the longest holiday of their life.
Yes, I liked how you put that. that's great, hey, it is.
Now, auto-enrollment, in my opinion, the topic of auto-enrollment is about to gather a lot of steam in the coming months and coming few years for the simple fact that social partners have been putting a lot of pressure on policymakers to introduce auto-enrollment. In fact, earlier this month, the finance minister, in his budget speech, confirmed that discussions were taking place and hoped that legislation, auto-enrollment legislation, will be set next year.
Very good. Very good. I'm going to move over to you, David, and bring you into this discussion. Of course, if I had to talk to someone about trade unions, it would probably be yourself. So I'm glad I'm putting this question forward to you and look forward to the answer. Basically, it is about their role and representative bodies. What is their role and how do you think are they going about it?
Well, it's been a long journey, Claire. When we kicked this off in 2004, we were looking at alternatives of how we can get people to save for retirement, because whatever type of model you talk to, the base is saving for your retirement. There was a consensus among the main social partners, trade unions representing employees and Chamber of Commerce, Malta Employers Association, etc., that a form of mandatory based saving instrument is something that they would not concur with. Mm-hmm. And there were reasons for that. The business community was worried that that would induce them additional costs, which would then render them less competitive. And the trade unions, which represent employees, were concerned on the impact of disposable income. So this is where we started from. It's been a journey of learning as well. Okay, it's been a process. And I've been involved in pension reform for the last 20 years. And last 2 years, I started working more directly with the General Workers Union and the Chamber of Commerce. And we built a consensus. And the consensus stems from the following. The General Workers Union has changed its position. Where before it used to focus purely for the term a person was in employment, mm-hmm. it's now looking at its responsibility for ensuring that person, when they come to retire, they have a good retirement. So now it's no longer really defined within the constraint of your job, but really where the job is going to take you when you come to retire. In terms of the business community, there is a very strong understanding that with an aging population, we will be over 35% would be 65 and over, and we're talking in 10 years' time. So this is in pensions discourse, this is round the corner, so to speak. What that means is that people, as they retire, because our pension system, without going into our complexities, is capped, okay? That would mean that people have less disposable income to spend during retirement. Now, when you consider that we're living longer, okay, what that means is that because elderly people won't have the purchasing power, and they are a larger cohort, that will impact the macroeconomic okay. economic environment. So they are seeing it as occupational pensions now as what we call consumption smoothening during a period, a person's life cycle. What does that mean? It means that you're deferring deferring consumption today, okay? It's not going into a tax, you're not going to lose it, but you're saving it so that you consume tomorrow.
Yes.
And around this around these points, we've built the consensus that automatic enrollment is the way forward for reasons that my colleague here was explaining.
Okay, very good. I think now it is time maybe that we open up to some of the questions that are going to be posed in and coming in from you. In fact, we already started having some questions. I'd like to rest your minds a little bit. If there are questions that we will not be able to answer during this half an hour which we have left, do not worry, because an APS representative will definitely clear your doubts about anything. So do keep on bringing your questions. So let's read out the first one we have, and this one seems to be for you, Darren. I am 62 years, born in 1962. I guess I'm late for the party, correct?
So, first okay. of all, I believe that it's never too late to start saving. The person asking the question is correct in a way that obviously the earlier you start, the more the likelihood is that you will retire with a nice sum because of many reasons that include, for example, compounding. Mm-hmm. Compounding over a long period of time is very, very powerful.
Yes.
However,
I remember learning this at school, compounding.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, it's vera.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Which works similarly to the snowball effect. Mm-hmm. Right.
That's it.
However, one can always invest in a pension plan, even in their 60s, because the law allows that drawdowns are to start latest by your 70th birthday. Now. Where does the advantage of starting a pension plan in your 60s come from? You can take advantage from the tax rebates.
Yes, so you're still in employment, so up until you are being paid, you're getting your tax rebate.
Exactly. Now, there is a capping of what tax rebate one is able to get when investing in a pension plan, and currently that is at 3,000 euro. Per year, 25% of 3,000 euro.
So you cannot invest less and get the 25%,
correct?
No,
you can invest less, but obviously you'll get 25% of the amount invested in a particular year.
Okay.
My advice to the person asking this question would be to consider investing the maximum one, to take full advantage of the tax rebate, and secondly, to build the largest pot possible in his particular circumstances.
Okay.
Now, if I can add to that, the we had introduced when we were designing the legislation, this goes back to 2007,
I believe. We were very concerned that we would have a replica of what happened in the UK back in the 90s, that and people would have saved in their pension pot. They take the full pension pot on retirement, and then they go to the Caribbean and they buy their Mercedeses and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And we were back to point zero, where the resources that would have been saved are lost into consumption. So. We had looked at the reforms that the UK had done, and we introduced the threshold of 70-30, so that there's always, so you can withdraw the 30%, right? And you take it as a lump sum, and to make it interesting, that would be tax-free. But 70% will remain for your retirement.
Yes, understand. So the 30%, you're saying the 30% you can take them before retirement? On retirement?
Yes, you can start taking them from the year of 61. So we had synced it with the 61-year-old, which was the old retirement.
So at 61 you can take your 30%,
that's right.
And the other 70% you have to take them, or you are allowed to take them bit by bit?
Bit by bit. Okay. Potentially they would be withdrawn.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, I need to ask a little bit about this, but I'll ask later, just so that we can, probably the audience that is watching us, know how they can take them, especially if they are into a retirement scheme already. But there may be others who have not. Let's see what questions pop up. And then if not, I'll come up with some more myself as well. I'm 30 years old and I would like to start a pension plan soon. What's the minimum amount of money I can put aside monthly? Minimum, okay. So not the maximum, the minimum. Would you like to take that, Mark?
Yeah, sure. Okay. I mean, it's a good question, and it's a question that we're asked a lot. What is the minimum? What is the minimum? Now, I'm going to answer it, but then I'll probably answer it a bit more fully. But the with us, it's 50 euros per month. Okay. So I think it's achievable for most people, 50 euros to put to one side. I will speak about our plan because I know it well. For example, it's very flexible. So if you start off even at the minimum level at 50 euros and for one reason or another you have to stop, you can. There's no penalty for doing it. Maybe there's a reason, maybe you buy a property, maybe you have children, whatever, but you can pause and then start again when ready. So this flexibility is very, very important for certainly younger people and certainly of the age of our questioner there. So very, very flexible. My honest answer to this person is if you put the minimum in, you're going to get the minimum out at the end of the day. So I would phrase it slightly differently when I'm asked the question about, which I'm often asked, what is the minimum? But I would ask it in a slightly different way. And I would ask that person, what do you want to get out of it? And then let's work backwards to see how much you have to put in to see what you want at the end. But the answer is 50 euros. And that's a first step in the right direction. Okay. And I would encourage him to do it.
I would go, is that the best you can do? That's not, yes, very, very well. I hope that answers your question, sir or madam, whoever posed that question. Another one is, I own a small business and have 5 employees. Will I be obliged to contribute over and above the social security contribution for my employees?
No. Okay. The way the voluntary occupational retirement pensions currently stand, the employer has no obligation to pay any contributions for their employees. As Mark mentioned earlier, should they do so, they will be entitled to the tax credit of the maximum threshold that we spoke about, and it's a P&L deductible okay. item. Now, in the discourse, the General Workers Union, Chamber of Commerce, and I have had in trying to shape how automatic enrollment will come together, potentially, what we're trying to do is two things. One is try to introduce automatic enrollment amongst larger employers through collective bargaining. Okay, so that would be a natural process, but that needs education both to employers and both to employees. And also trying to see how we can pool together small employers, okay, so that we minimize the cost of administration. So, you know, I'm self-employed. I used to run a business with six people. So managing the cost is very important.
Yes.
So we're looking at potential how that could be elevated when you consider 96% of our
businesses are
micro, yes, micro, below yes, yes. 10 and under, mm-hmm. that becomes an important component.
Of course. Okay. So I hope you rest assured that you're going to be taken care of in the process of this auto enrollment. Another question. I'm 29 years old and have made no plans for my retirement. It's nice that we have a diverse audience watching us from a younger age on to 60. How do I go about it? Where are the funds invested? Okay, so 29, no plans for retirement. How does one go about it, and where are the funds being invested?
Okay, I'd say to this person that they're not alone. There's lots of 29-year-olds out there that have done absolutely nothing for their retirement. However, one thing I would mention, when we are talking to people around that age, they are interested in the subject, but like this person, they're not quite sure what to do. What's the first step? First, I would encourage them to have a conversation with their employer. Are their employer looking to introduce a scheme at work? Okay. If they do, that's quite an easy route in, and hopefully their employer would contribute to that as well. So I would ask them to gauge that. In addition to that, they could always start their own provision from that 50 euros that I mentioned. And I would encourage them to go for the most flexible options that they possibly can. And I think that there was a point made about where is this money invested? And that's an important consideration because, yes, it's a long-term plan, but you've got to make sure that where you invest your money matches your investment appetite. How much risk are you prepared to take? There are different options. For example, I mean, on our plan, we offer a cautious plan, which mainly invests in government bonds and cash and things like that. Okay, so not high volatility. Then there's the growth plan, which is more geared towards stocks and shares and equities. Then we have something in the middle, which is a bit of both, okay, called the balance plan. And we have an ethical option as well. And these days, Claire, we find that many people, especially young people, are interested in the environment and how they can make a difference. And that's a big way that they can make a difference to society, the way they save and where they put their money.
Yes.
If I can latch on to how do I go about it, I think it's important to mention that the government has a financial capability education platform, which is Gemma. So
what is it?
Gemma.
Gemma. Oh, yes.
Okay. Gemma.gov.mt,
which
is very rich in terms of video,
okay,
tools, content. And, I think it is something that this gentleman or lady and others who are following go through the site. Gemma.gov.mt.
And just on that final point, Claire, following on what David was saying, of course, it can be very confusing. You know, where do you start? And if you have a trusted financial advisor that you can speak to, that's pretty good. That's a pretty good start. And laws are changing all the time. Tax breaks are changing. As Dan was saying, auto enrollment, it looks like it's coming in. And David was giving a good background to it. So these things are fluid and changing. So having a financial advisor on your side means that you don't have to spend all your time researching for forever and a day until you retire. Someone's there supporting you to point you in the right direction.
What is very important that they are certified financial advisors.
Okay, very good.
Certified financial advisors.
Very good. To go back just a little bit on the fund, just so I make sure I understand you correctly. So when we are doing our pension plans, this fund, whether we buy into this scheme or the other, there is still no guarantee.
Well, that. Yeah, I mean, with that, as far as the returns are concerned, no, there's no guarantees on the returns.
And the amount?
The capital, again, the capital is subject to fluctuations. There are so-called guaranteed plans out there. And this is where having this conversation with a financial advisor would be useful.
Yes.
The point I would make, and I touched upon this within my presentation about the effects of inflation.
Yes.
Historically, as you could see, it knocks about 2-3% off in real terms on the value of your money. Now, if someone's offering you a 2% guaranteed return, mm-hmm. on the face of it, this is great because there's no fluctuations and it looks quite good. But if you then start building in the effects of inflation, in real terms, your money, probably the only guarantee that you're going to get is that your money's going to lose its purchasing power.
Yes.
So yes, there are guaranteed options available. There's flexible options available. But again, in my presentation, where the example I gave, where if you do your own research as well, which I encourage people to do, and look at trends over the long term, and a retirement plan is a long-term investment.
Yes.
So let this trend be your friend.
Yes.
And get the maximum returns that you possibly can.
Fantastic, thank you. Let's see some more questions. How are occupational pension schemes regulated and governed to ensure the security and proper management of employees' pension funds? Okay, I think, David, this is...
Well, there's a regulatory framework that is designed by the Malta Financial Services Authority, which tends to reflect very much the UK experience. I think a very essential point here is the segregation, the ring fencing of the contributions paid for pensions from the employer's
yes.
business-related costs. All this comes from the Murdoch, or I always get confused, Murdoch, wasn't it? Back in the 90s, where he robbed the pension fund to keep his empire going. But I think there's a lot that is yet to be done. And I will mention
Maxwell.
I always mix up the two. And I mentioned two points. One, what we're going to see happening, particularly if automatic enrollment comes in, is that pension funds will constitute a considerable part of the community of equity of the families. So there is an issue here. What happens if there is a divorce and a separation? Okay, where will the money go? How will the money be divided? At what point will it be divided? And in our jurisprudence, there is nothing at the moment. Mm. So, and this is a technical subject, so you know, one does not necessarily expect. So this is an area which, in my opinion, we need to start looking into now, because these pots are going to grow, marriages will break down, and it will become a contentious issue. The second is we don't have what you find in other jurisdictions like the UK, which is a pension protection fund. As Mark stated, there are guarantee funds that guarantee the income you put in, okay,
mm-hmm.
But they come with a more cautious return, right? Because the guarantee offsets the risk. But if we go to automatic enrollment, okay, now government has a moral responsibility here. Why? Because by design, okay, we're introducing a pension system that through behavior triggers you to remain enrolled, okay? Which is a very, very important point. Now, what that means is that that investment should therefore be protected should there be a bankruptcy or fraud of a pension provider.
Okay.
These two examples that I mentioned are not here as we speak,
mm-hmm.
and they are things I think that we should be looking into.
And be put on the table for sure. To continue discussing. Thank you, David. Another question. I've spoken to a couple of pension plan companies and plugged in the numbers. I have yet to see one with such a high interest rate. Is this honestly representative of possible interest rates to be received? I've been told that they are not fixed rates. Okay.
Okay.
Can you grasp the
I think so. I think that's right, because there's so many different types of investments out there and different types of funds. And a traditional fund is something called a with-profit fund. So this money is pooled together with lots of other investors, and each year a bonus rate is issued.
Yes.
Okay, and once it's issued, once it's declared, it's added to the pot and can't be taken away. So it adds this guaranteed element. So the good news with these type of plans, these with-profit investments, is that they offer a lot of security. They offer a wide range of investments. So that's good, and so that's appealing to many people. The downside to it is, if you look at recent years, the interest rate, the growth rate on these things, have been relatively low. I mean, I'm talking, again, 2%, something like that, on average per year, maybe a bit more. But these things can fluctuate. And even when markets turn negative, these rates can drop as well. So if you're looking as far as a fund that's offering a good rate, as it were, with profits are out there, and it's something which is right for some people but not right for everyone, and it's something worth looking at. But look at the guaranteed returns that they're looking to give, and do your own research.
Okay.
with those things. I hope I've answered that question okay.
Okay, moving on. Darren, another question. This one's directed to you. If we have a pension plan, is it guaranteed that we get what we invested over the years, and not an excuse that the market is not good at the moment, etc.? A little bit of a concern like I had, and I just asked. And we'll end up not getting what we invested, or maybe the company will have the pension plan dissolved.
So this is a question that most people looking to invest in any product would ask. Basically, when it comes to a pension plan, the answer which I like to give, and the assurance I like to give to a certain extent, is very different to other forms of investment.
Okay.
Just to add something about what Mark was saying, was that there are products which guarantee the capital. But as Mark correctly said, obviously, the return is very low. And because of inflation, when you are investing in something which is for the long term, in reality, you would be losing money, literally, because, just to give an example, if inflation rate is on average 2-3% per year, and the return on your investment is less than that, then in real terms, you would be getting less money.
Yes.
Than what you would have invested. Now,
your purchasing power.
Exactly.
Yes. Yes.
And an important point as well, just to add to what Darren said, is if you think about how pensions actually work and how most people save into these things, and how they save is to drip feed the amounts in. Not many people have the financial resources to put in big lump sums. So what they tend to do is that they put in regular monthly amounts.
Okay.
And the good thing about drip feeding it into a market, whichever market it is, markets go up and down, all markets will go up and down. But by drip feeding the amount in, what you're actually doing is that you're buying when the prices are high, then the next month maybe the prices are low, then maybe the next month they're high, then they're low, then they're high. But on average, as the market shows us, history tells us, over the long term, markets tend to move upwards. So what you're actually doing is that you're purchasing at different points, and that means that you're averaging out those returns and getting a decent return. In fact, last year was a very difficult year for investments across the board. The last couple of years have been a difficult time. But now markets have picked up. So those people that we were speaking to last year that had their concerns because they were investing last year, what's actually happened is that last year, because it was difficult, they were buying it at relatively low levels. Now the market's moved up and they're making money on their purchases of last year. So again, let this trend work for you. History teaches us a lot about this, and I would encourage everyone to keep all their options open and try to maximize the returns. And the important thing about maximizing your return is if you don't maximize your return, you have to pay in more money out of your wages yourself to get the same result at the end.
Yes.
Isn't it better to let the market do half the work for you?
Yes, exactly. So if you want to go on holiday when you are retired, and buying that holiday when you are 65 is going to cost you much more than if you... Yes.
No, just to add to Mark's comments, basically in addition to that, before I said that pension plans are a bit different to other types of investments because they are very long-term in nature.
Yes.
Now, through drip feeding into the pension plan, obviously, you are investing at different stages of the market. Now, choosing a strategy which is riskier over the long term is very highly likely to pay off much more than going for a very, very negative strategy. For the simple fact that usually more aggressive strategies would invest a larger portion of the money in equities and less in bonds and cash.
Okay.
Now, it is in the nature of the markets that over the long term, equities rise much more than bonds and cash, bank rates, all right? So that is where the compounding effect comes in. I would encourage the viewers to log on to the Gemma website and make use of the compound interest calculator. And this is an Excel sheet, which is an excellent tool to plan ahead, to plan how you're gonna save and where you want to arrive. Imagine I want to save 100 euro per month, for example, and I will retire in 30 years. Going for a conservative strategy, which would yield at best 2 or 3% versus going to a balanced strategy, which would yield around 4 to 6%, there would already be a very big difference in the final amount.
Yes.
Let alone going for a bit of a more aggressive strategy, which is more volatile in nature, but it doesn't mean you're going to lose your money because the way the strategy invests, it invests in many different companies, many different bonds, many different shares. So in essence, you do not, the risk of default in reality is very minimal.
But yes. I would like to add a very important proviso to what is being said. We have to make sure that people have a glide path in their investment. What does that mean? The crash in 2008, okay, was apart from the housing issue and all that. Pensioners lost in 2008. Pension funds were wiped out because people, when they were young, invested in equity, and at 61, they still were in equity. Okay, so what does a glide path do? A glide path takes the first number of years, 7, 10 years, 12, and places you aggressively. Because if the market crashes, there is sufficient time for a rebound. And as you start getting closer to retirement, it starts shifting your funds, okay, to very conservative. Because the last thing you want is you have everything in equity, there is a crash, and everything is gone. Now, and this is the major lesson that came out from the financial crash in 2008 with regard to pension funds. And today, I would imagine most pension funds have a default glide path. But a person, in my opinion, should make sure that he asks or she asks that whatever investment she does
has this glide path. You don't want to be caught when you retire with a portfolio of equity and you have a Black Monday or something, and the whole thing goes up in smoke. Okay.
In fact, through our pension plans, it is very easy to change the strategy when it makes sense to do so.
And you will be doing that without the client knowing?
No, we would advise the client.
You would advise, okay, because you would be obviously managing in a way.
Exactly.
You know, what's
exactly.
Okay.
Without any charges whatsoever.
Okay, well. Very good. Okay, so question, we are coming down to almost the end of this session, but we've been doing very well. You've given us tremendous information. Once again, I'll remind all viewers that just in case we do not have the time to answer the questions that you have put into the Q&A section, do not worry, because an APS representative will be answering them after the session. So let's take this question. Are there any entry, ongoing charges or fees for the APS private pension plan? I think you mentioned that, but let's just clarify it.
Yeah, no problem. And again, this is a common question across the board with all pension products, and not just for APS, but it's important that maybe the viewers take this point seriously and do their research on this particular point. First, I would say it's important to go to a trusted company, a company that you trust, and maybe an advisor that you trust. And to make sure that you're given all the details, because it's a fact that some fees are not as transparent as they should be.
Yes.
in the market, and I think you would agree. Yes. With that. And I, you know, it's down to everyone to be transparent. What I would point them to do, there's a document called the key features document on all these, and they have to by law list all their charges and that is a very, very good document to compare, to look at, where you'll see in every set of circumstances what these features are.
Okay.
I would make the point, however, when you're looking at this, if they're transparent and it makes sense to you,
then
that's fine. If they start using confusing language and terminology, and you know, smoke and mirrors, and you're not quite sure what's going on here, they're not as transparent as they should be. Okay. Now, for example, just very quickly, because I know we're running out of time, but to address this question head on, that for example, on our APS personal pension, there's an initial charge on the personal pension. On our occupational scheme, because it's a group structure, there's no initial charges.
Okay.
So this is because we're pooling a lot of it, people together all at once. So if it was set up for 50 people, 100 people, or whatever, it's much easier to set up that kind of scheme than to give advice for each individual.
Okay.
So there is a charge. There's a 15% initial charge on the APS personal pension.
Yes.
Plan. But there's no charge on the by joining your occupational scheme. So this is a big advantage. And if I may say, Claire, just to slip this in, funnily enough, we're starting a special offer tomorrow on the personal pension, which we're going to give back up to 175. So really, that's going to get rid of a lot of these charges. But again, the golden rule is to understand the product, make sure they're transparent, and make sure it's clear, and read these key features documents very carefully.
When I was running Gemma together with APS, we had done a document to explain the key terms relating to pension products in simple language, and this is downloadable from the Gemma website.
Very good. So we encourage people to
go
into the Gemma. I think this brings us to the end. Really, we just have our final seconds. I must thank you, Mark, Darren, and David for being with us this afternoon, this evening. Now, I would once again like to ask all those who have questions, don't worry about it, you are going to be replied to. But also, we will show you a poll. We'd like to give you this question, and this will help facilitate as well any further questions that you have. And the poll, it says that if you wish to be contacted by an APS investment advisor for more information and also to benefit from special offers with your investing, such as the one that Mark mentioned today. So thank you very much for watching.
Thank
I would
you.
Like to remind you that tomorrow we will have a final final session, and the topic of that will be Navigate Local Investments. Focus on the local markets, short and medium term outlooks. So if you'd like to register, please visit apsbank.com.mt/chats. And you can also watch all these sessions on our YouTube channel, the APS Bank YouTube channel. And with that, I will leave you for this evening and hope to see you tomorrow. Good night.